The following program is brought to you in part by the film Backdoor Channels, The Price of Peace.
Welcome to another Leon Charney Report, and we're going to talk to you about George Bush today, and that's an interesting topic. We'll find out a little bit about what George Bush thinks, what we think he thinks about the Middle East, especially what's going on there, and all of us know how tragic it is with so much killing. We've got Stuart Stevens on, who worked on a Bush campaign, and he's written a really interesting book called The Big Enchilada. And that's obviously George W. Bush, not his senior, but the junior. Stuart, I read through parts of this book. It's very funny. You're a witty man.
Thanks.
What does a witty man do with a bunch of Texans, by the way?
Well, you know, I grew up in Mississippi, and all Mississippians aspire to be Texans. They see it as a higher state of being.
They like the boots?
They like the, I think, the self-confidence the Texans have, which is very endearing, I think. You know, I think Americans like Texans more than they dislike them. I think this is one of the critical mistakes the Gore campaign made, was trying to attack Bush by attacking Texas, the way that in the first Bush campaign we attacked Massachusetts. And it just never worked for him.
Why did Bush win?
I think he won because of a national exhaustion with Clinton. And I think Gore lost the campaign the day that he went out on the South Lawn after Clinton was impeached and put on his pom-poms and called him the greatest president ever. It's one of these sort of Faustian bargains in life, I think, that had Gore and other members of the cabinet that Clinton had lied to, had they resigned or threatened to resign and forced Clinton to resign, which would have happened in England and in a lot of places, and Gore had become president, I think he'd still be president today.
Because of a parliamentary system, they would have brought him down. All right, Stuart, what was your position in the Bush campaign?
I worked on the television advertising and strategy, which is my background. I'm that evil permutation of the system known as a media consultant. I was brought into the campaign by Karl Rove, who had worked with a lot.
His senior political analyst,
right,
or a strategist, really.
Right. And a guy named Mark McKinnon, who really assembled a media team. Mark says, wonderful character from Austin, who had been a Democrat, had been Ann Richards' press secretary, actually.
Really?
Yeah. And which
George Bush, we have to point out, beat Ann Richards in the governor's campaign.
In 94.
Right.
And Mark had been her press secretary in 90. When she beat Clady Williams and what was seen as a big upset at the time, though Clady kind of committed suicide.
Well, one second. Remember that remark that Ann Richards made at the convention that George Bush was born, George Bush Sr. with a golden spoon or something like that, right?
Born with a silver spoon. Yeah, she also used to say that he was born on third base and thought he hit a homer. Or thought he hit a triple, I guess. Which actually, I think Ann Richards really did a disservice. That was again the Dukakis convention.
Convention, yeah.
Because, you know, once she kind of went with that nastiness and that personal attack, it kind of gave Republicans permission to go after Dukakis. And it was difficult for them to say, well, you know, we want to run a high-minded campaign. But a very flamboyant character, a real Texas character. And Mark had worked for Ann Richards and then gotten out of politics and had gotten to be friends with Governor Bush. They share this mutual interest in education. Mark has teenage daughters, as does President Bush. And the governor lured Mark out of retirement. And Mark brought me in, really, to be sort of his Republican beard. And I'd worked a lot in the...
Are you a Republican?
Yeah, yeah.
How long?
Oh, you know, when I grew up in Mississippi, we didn't have parties.
Cause Southern Democrats.
There were only Democrats.
Southern Democrats.
So I was part of this crowd like Haley Barbour, that we all became Republicans. We didn't know what it meant.
Haley Barbour was the national chairman of the Republican Party.
Right.
A little overweight sometimes.
Haley's well-fed, prosperous, shall we say. You know, he ran for the Senate against John Stennis, and I did his campaign, and he lost 60 pounds. And the night he lost the campaign, it was sort of a toss-up whether or not he was more disappointed to lose, but now he could eat again, so it was some consolation. But we all became Republicans, not because we knew what Republicans were, but because we knew we didn't want to be like the old line Democrats, who were, you know, John Stennis, John Eastland. It's very difficult to work both sides of the fence here. A few people have tried.
Dick Morris did it.
Dick, which is proof probably that it can't be done successfully.
It shouldn't be done.
David Garth is probably the most successful example here in New York.
Right.
But David does it, gets away with it pretty much by only doing people that he can get to by subway. You know, he doesn't really work around the country as much.
Well, David handled Koch and Giuliani.
And he handled Giuliani.
Right.
And he does Arlen Specter.
In Pennsylvania.
In Pennsylvania, which is a long subway ride, but close.
He was the first guy, very few people know, to get involved in the campaigns in Israel.
Oh, is that right? I didn't know.
No. He started, originally tried to be involved or was involved with Asa Weitzman in a campaign for a party called Yachad in the 1980s. And he sent one of his people over there. He's very involved in Israel. And after that came Greenberg and Carvel. Where's Carvel from? Is he Mississippi?
Louisiana.
That's close enough. And they all went and ran this campaign, one for Barack, and then you had this guy in New York, this famous Finkelstein.
Arthur
Finkelstein.
I've worked a lot with Arthur.
Was running his BB. So we'll talk about him. He's also an interesting guy. Anyway, so you got connected to the Bush people.
I was brought down, and you know, normally.
Tell me the first thing you thought of when you saw George W. Bush.
He always has a twinkle. He's one of these guys who is always sort of kidding you or himself. You know, there's so much about life, but particularly about politics, that is sort of, you're sort of going through the motions. There's sort of social conventions here. You know, I met him over at Carl's house for dinner several years ago. And, you know.
Before you were working for him?
Before I was working for him. And ostensibly, it was not to talk to him about working for him.
Right.
But, you know, he knew there was a little bit of matchmaking going on here. And he loves to sort of let it be known that he knows these things. Whereas a lot of people would just sort of pretend that this wasn't happening. But he's always, you know, he'd say, so Carl wants us to start dating. You know, I mean, that's classic George W. Bush.
Is he smart?
I think he's wicked smart.
People think the opposite.
I know. It's interesting. Just as they thought Gerry Ford was probably our most unathletic president was. Our most athletic president was unathletic.
Right.
I think that's really a function of life imitating high school, in the sense that he has let it be known that he really isn't concerned how sort of the particularly Eastern media elite judge him, whether or not they think he's smart or not smart. And I think that his sort of rejection of their ability to judge him tends to engender this sense, well, then, you know, he can't be very smart.
And he likes to keep it out there. It diffuses people.
He has a self-deprecating manner. No, he's very unpompous.
Yeah, I saw that.
And I think that it's a sign of how smart he is that he has the confidence to do that. He's someone who doesn't always have to impress you that he knows more about something than anybody else, which is part of his sort of leadership/management style.
Well, you know what Bill Clinton said?
No.
He'd rather spend 1 hour with George Bush when they met.
Mm-hmm.
Was more invigorating for him than spending 8 years with Al Gore.
Did he really say that?
Yeah. Newsweek printed that.
Well, it.
I'm sure that Bush thinks that Clinton is a very smart, charismatic guy too.
Yeah, he does. He has a lot of respect for his political skills.
I'm sure he does.
You know, President Bush is a very difficult guy not to like.
You know, that way. I mean,
even my wife, who's sort of a communist, you know, used to always kid him that she was never going to vote for him. And you know, he said, "Why? What are you going to vote for Al Gore? I can't imagine this." He goes, no, I'm going to vote for Ralph Nader. He goes, "Well, that's okay. You can vote for Nader." You know, but he has a wonderful way to really, in situations, policy situations, these kind of things, to really get to the central questions, kind of cut through the BS and sort of, and he's not afraid to ask like very fundamental questions. You know, there's an incident that's been reported, and I wasn't there, I only know what I read about it, where, you know, he was talking with national security people and he was asking questions like, you know, what is the role of the Army in our society? And I think this is like,
good question.
This is a good question.
Very good question.
It's like a smart question, you know?
Right.
But, you know, if you want to make fun of it, you can say, well, look, what is this guy? You know, he's asking, what is the role of the Army? He doesn't know what the role of the Army is. So, you know, I think it's just how you look at this. And it's one of the sweet ironies for those of us who worked in the campaign and admire the man, and which everyone who did work in the campaign, I think, did admire him, that you can make a good case that he won the campaign through the debates. And
really,
I think that Al Gore and the whole crowd around him really thought that in the debates that he would sort of
fade.
Yeah, just be like an ice cube on a, you know, summer sidewalk.
Right.
And just, and you'd see how smart Al Gore was, and George W. Bush, you know, who was a Texan, who it would just, you know, be clear. And in fact, you know, I think,
you know, the chances are, you remember the Nixon-Kennedy debates.
Right.
People say that on the radio,
right,
Nixon won the debate, whereas
right,
Kennedy won on his personality,
right,
in television. It's probably the same thing. If they would have argued on a radio without a visual, because Al Gore looked like he really is, you know. He's sort of this, he thinks he is the smartest guy in the world,
right,
and he's got a lot of hubris. In a funny way, and the other guy came off, your friend Bush, came off as a sincere, fun-loving, you know, American guy who, you know, likes to eat hot dogs and then go out and...
But you know, I think he came across as as smart. And he, you know, a lot of times Gore just says stuff, like, you know, what he said about Russia and Yugoslavia and Russia's role in Yugoslavia in that first debate. He just asserts things that are wrong. That are factually
wrong. Yeah, he did a lot of that.
But he does it with...
He invented the internet.
But he does it with great panache. You know, it's sort of a debating trick.
I've been with Al Gore. I know him fairly well.
Yeah.
And he should relax. A couple of Xanax or Valium would help him, really.
I've always heard that on a one-on-one or smaller groups, he's much more relaxed. I don't know. I've never seen him.
Not necessarily.
Not necessarily, huh?
You know, it's interesting, his wife... She's mm-hmm. far more tense than people think if you meet her in person.
That's interesting.
She's a little bit tense. And maybe she has problems in her back. I don't know. You know, but she's not relaxed. Or maybe the times that I met them, they were so hyped up to,
right,
to be on that, who knows, you know. When I know Jimmy Carter intimately well. I know,
right,
Yitzhak Rabin intimately well. I,
right,
knew Shimon Peres. I know him very well. I know a lot of world leaders very well. I, you know, I don't know Gore that well. I know him a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
When Jimmy Carter, you're alone with him one-on-one, he's the most charismatic guy in the world.
No,
and it's a spiritual experience to be with him. When you leave him, mm-hmm, you feel that the world has a higher level of morality or something. He's just a spiritual man.
I can remember I was a student at Oxford in 1972, and he came over and spoke. This is, you know, obviously before
he was a governor.
Yeah, he was a governor, and he came over and kind of got together. Maybe it's 1973, and he got together sort of Southerners who were there, and just, you know, talked to us, a small group. You know, I thought he was just wildly impressive.
He was very effective in a small group. I don't think he was a great public speaker.
Right.
I didn't think he communicated well, and I thought he was too truthful to the nation at times. That morose speech, I mean, who wants to hear morose?
Right.
I was at the convention when Walter Mondale said, I'm going to raise taxes. I mean,
that's one of my favorite moments.
That's a pass to lose elections. I mean, you don't have to try hard on that one. But we got to really discover who George Bush is. Now, you stay with him until when? Until after the election?
Well, until till the end in Florida.
Yeah.
They'll really, for Florida, guys that do what I do, we had no role. I mean, you know, I stayed in Austin, but, you know, we had this terrible predicament that instead of elections being decided by guys like me making commercials, they were being decided by, like, judges, you know, clearly was a...
Has George W. read the book, or you don't know?
You know, my friend Mark McKinnon, who I did the campaign with, he was staying in the White House and gave the president a copy, and apparently he did read it and liked it. And was telling Mark, in fact, this has been reported to him that he liked it.
Really? All right, we got to cut for a break. We'll come back with the very interesting Stuart Stevens, who's written a book called The Big Enchilada, and that means the Texan man. That's George W., and he's going to tell us a little bit more about the people around him. We got to know more about George Bush. He's the president of the free world, and he squeaked in, so it's like 50-50. We have to depend on people like Stu to give us the clues as to really what George Bush is like. We'll be right back.
In modern Middle East history, only one peace treaty has stood the test of time, the 1978 Camp David Accord. In the new documentary film, Backdoor Channels, The Price of Peace, learn the true story behind the greatest diplomatic achievement of our time and its lessons for the future.
The price of peace is very high, to have this courageous man and my close friend killed.
Winner of the Telly Award for Best Cultural Program. Now available at select stores, including Barnes & Noble, and online at Amazon.com. Now get the book the hit movie was based on, Leon Charney's Backdoor Channels. Learn about the backdoor channel negotiations that led to the historic 1978 Israeli-Egyptian peace treaty. Become a witness to history and order Backdoor Channels online at Amazon or Barnes & Noble. Also available at all other retailers and booksellers. Or download the audiobook at iTunes or Audible.com. Relive history. Order Backdoor Channels. Leon Charney sets out to discover the true meaning of the Kaddish, the Jewish custom of reciting a prayer to commemorate the death of a close relative. Join Charney as he finds out the history of the Kaddish and how it has evolved. Reviewed as a refreshing walk through Jewish history and a book that deserves to be read by both Jews and non-Jews, The Mystery of the Kaddish is now available online at Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and all other retailers and booksellers. Or download the audiobook at audible.com or on iTunes. Discover The Mystery of the Kaddish. Get best-selling author Leon Charney's latest book, The Battle of the Two Talmuds. Join Charney as he explores years of Jewish history to find out why and how Talmudic scholars and rabbis abandoned the Holy Land for the lands of the diaspora. Learn about the power struggles behind the creation of the Jerusalem and Babylonian Talmuds. It's a book critics call engaging and enlightening. A book which will be of interest to people of every faith. Now available at Amazon and Barnes & Noble. Or download the audiobook of The Battle of the Two Talmuds at iTunes or Audible.com. Available now over iTunes, Amazon, and Google Play. Leon Charney's cantorial CD and Disco Lam. Listen as Charney movingly sings El Mole Rachamim and Charney's amazing rendition of a disco remix of Adon Olam, all sung in the incredible and individual Charney style. Also listen to the CDs on Rhapsody. Download Leon Charney's cantorial songs and Disco Lam, the disco remix of Adon Olam on Amazon, iTunes, and Google Play. Or listen in on Rhapsody. All available now.
I'm back. I'm Leon Charney. We're talking to Stuart Stevens, who is my lifeline right now to The Big Enchilada, which is a book that he wrote about the George Bush, W. Bush campaign. Stuart, I have a theory that George Bush Sr. is controlling the foreign policy of this country with guys like Jim Baker and that old crowd.
Yet.
What do you think?
Oh, I don't think so.
No?
No, I think it's very much the president and Condi Rice, who is arguably the most impressive human on the planet. Obviously, Secretary Powell, the vice president. Now, I couldn't pretend to know the intricacies of that relationship between the father and son, but I tend to think that it is one more of general support than specific policies. I know in the campaign he was very reluctant to offer any specific advice. I think that he had been in that situation and he knows how difficult it is for anyone who's not right there in that moment to understand sort of...
How close are they?
Oh, I think the whole family's very close.
Right, George Bush and Israel, what's his position as you know it?
Well,
let me run a little background tape.
Yeah.
All right? Because this show, I said, does a lot on the Middle East. right now, and I don't blame him for the original time being that he had hands off and let the people over there try to really eke it out. I was in Israel when the Dolphinarium was bombed. I saw the whole thing. The question was, what do you do? Now, the Foreign Secretary of Germany was there, Fischer.
Mm-hmm.
He was jogging, and he missed the Dolphinarium bombing by about 20 minutes
himself.
Right. So then he went down to see Arafat, and he says, we got to get a ceasefire here. And then he went up and saw Sharon and said, we got to get a ceasefire here. So they put in a ceasefire, which doesn't really hold. Then a fellow named George Tenet comes over, the head of the CIA, and he puts the Tenet plan out. Tenet plan, there's another ceasefire which doesn't hold. Then George Mitchell's report comes out, and they try to use that as a basis for negotiation. Meanwhile, you have terrorism, you have suicide bombers, it's terrible. And there is now tremendous pressure on the United States to get involved. Now, you have to face that, which Bill Clinton, he was too involved, in my opinion. It was too much so, too involved, too close to the whole thing. His heart was in the right place, but in order to be in the Middle East, you got to know the Middle East.
Right.
And you just can't do it by running in and meeting prime ministers and running around the strips for 2 minutes. I think it's imperative that the United States get involved right now, and I'll tell you why. The only force that can really be acceptable in the world by Yasser Arafat is the United States. George W. has never invited him yet. You know, Clinton was inviting him every 4 hours. He's never invited him, which is telling something to him. The question is, and I'm giving you the question in a lot of Israeli leaders' minds, is how much is oil influencing the policy of George Bush? Now, you may not know, and I don't know, but I'm
asking. Well, I can't pretend to be on any sort of inside. Anything I would say would be pure speculation. I think that it is his general feeling that often the United States in the past has acted rather arrogantly in a number of spheres, not just in Israel, and that ultimately you can't have peace unless there's a desire for peace, be it, you know, in any sphere. I am very much in if I were an Israeli, I'd be very much a right-wing Israeli on this stuff. I believe in the whole moral imperative of Israel. I think that it's impossible for those of us in the United States or in Europe to imagine what it's like to be an Israeli. I think that the heart of the attacks on Israel are by definition anti-Semitic. I mean, they're blowing up these people because they're Jews. I think that if we had Mexicans who were blowing themselves up in Times Square because they said that we stole Texas, we wouldn't want another country saying that we don't have a right to deal with the problem as we saw fit. I think the greatest thing the United States can do is guarantee the security of Israel so that it can never be a question that Israel won't exist. I think that often we approach the Mideast, we have approached the Mideast with great naivete, with an unappreciation of the fact that its very survival is threatened. And I am of the Arafat is a thug school.
When you were at the campaign, was the Middle East a big issue to talk about, to get to?
It was never an issue in the campaign, really, because there really wasn't much of a difference of opinion. And I think that as a candidate, then Governor Bush was always, and not just in the Mideast, but in the Balkans as well, was always careful to support the president, even if
I remember
he might have done something different.
I remember that.
If were he president,
you know, the irony is that George W. when he was governor went to Israel and Ariel Sharon took him around at that time, and he was not the prime minister.
Right, they went with four governors. They went.
And
that's true. I'd forgotten that. That's right. They went in January of 1999.
And they sort of bonded. They really had something together, and they seem to have a good personal relationship, but there's a lot of curiosity as to what the Middle East policy will be. And I know it's pro-Israel in the sense that you're going to make sure that Israel's not destroyed, but the question is when or how. And I think that you got to get Egypt and Jordan and the United States to come together and put this tremendous pressure on Arafat. What Arafat's trying to do, I don't know if you're interested.
Yeah, I am interested.
He's trying to get himself some popularity with the European Union. So he's really happy. Fischer is in Israel right now. He's the foreign minister of Germany. And what they're playing for is some kind of sympathy in the European Union. And as I said on the show about 2 weeks ago, Bashar Assad, who wiped out with virulent attacks the Jewish people and Israel, was given a 21-gun salute at the Palace of France and probably a great French meal and the whole enchilada.
Well, you know, I think every 40 years Europe goes crazy, and usually it takes people who speak English to, a lot of them have to die to get them uncrazy. And I think that Europe, in its own quiet way, is sort of going crazy now. I think this whole notion of the euro is an absolutely nutty idea. And I'm, you know, one of these embarrassing people who spend a lot of time in France and like talk about how wonderful it is. But usually they do the wrong thing.
Politically.
Eventually they might be brought to do the right thing. But I think that their view of the world is almost always just wrong. It's just a question of how wrong is it. This is a nutty idea that they have, that they're going to combine Europe into some sort of super state. And yet on the other hand, they say they don't want to be like the United States. It's just an absolutely nutty idea, and you can see how the financial markets have reacted to the euro. It's a great time to go to Europe now because the euro is
collapsed.
It's tanking.
Europe's no good. I mean, it doesn't work very well. I agree with you. Tell me, Stuart, who are the main people around George Bush who really have influence? I know Condoleezza Rice is very powerful.
Right.
There's even reports that she may be more powerful than Secretary Powell. You're not going to comment on that.
I don't know how many angels dance on the head of a pin. I mean, that's such a sort of...
Yeah, well, Henry Kissinger played that role pretty well.
Yeah, I mean, I think that they have different roles.
They
would complement each other. I don't think that it's like a sports team where you line up and say who has the most powerful line.
I think the difference? I'll tell you, because of my relationship with Jimmy Carter when I was running around for him in the Middle East. I'll ask you a $64,000 question.
All right.
Where is the Situation Room in the United States?
Downstairs in the basement. Yeah.
And who's closer to it? The Secretary of State or the National Security Advisor?
It is the National Security Advisor's office.
That's right.
Yes.
So you get my gist, right?
Yeah. Yeah, but I mean, this is what's interesting to me, and not to step on your friend Jimmy Carter's toes, but as we were talking earlier, the last time a group of close-knit people who were only involved in the presidential race because of a connection to a candidate got elected was in the case of Jimmy Carter.
Right.
And that's happened now. But I think that this Bush administration, has avoided a lot of the mistakes of the Carter administration in that they... often the Carter administration seemed to be sort of rubes come to Washington, and that was impression at first, you know, and particularly with Jody Powell and Ham Jordan, and for a lot of reasons, not...
Hamilton Jordan's only problem was he liked Egyptian women, that's all.
Well, we haven't shot anybody all day for that, but for a lot of reasons, one of which I think is the fact that he is the son of a president and had seen this before. Part of it is, I think, his management technique. He is the first MBA that we've ever had elected president, which I think is not insignificant. Part of it's his personality. Part of it is just that he's a really smart guy. But they, I think, have operated very smoothly. And you have Condi Rice, you have Josh Bolton, who's in the campaign was head of policy, coordinated policy. He's now deputy chief of staff to the White House. You have a guy that isn't in the news very much, but is in the Situation Room and there with Condi Rice, named Gary Edson, who's a very smart guy, had worked for Carla Hills. You have John Bridgeland, who's head of domestic policy, who was Josh's deputy in the White House. And of course you have Karl Rove and Karen Hughes.
These people have been with him a long time, haven't they?
Carl and Karen have been with him a very long time. Yes, Carl's relationship with the president goes back over 20 years. You know, what's interesting to me, the press makes fun of how much, for the most part, how much people who work for President Bush admire President Bush. You know, Maureen Dowd's always writing, you know, the fawning Karen Hughes, or, you know, the besottened Karl Rose, you know. But and it's a very funny thing, because, you know, that didn't happen for people who worked for Kennedy. You know, no one said about Schlesinger, you know, the fawning Schlesinger.
It's Eastern establishment.
And you know, when Katharine Graham died, and all of these journalists wrote justifiably fawning pieces about her, about how wonderful she was. Nobody said, well, why are these journalists, you know? They admired Katharine Graham, and that's a good thing. And people who work for the president have a tremendous respect for me, myself included. And, you know, this book that I wrote, I didn't want it to be a kiss and tell like Stephanopoulos's book, or like Dick Morris's book, or Robert Ross's book.
Did you get permission from anybody before you wrote it?
No, I didn't. Didn't ask, and you know, I don't really think they were worried, because I think that they knew that the kind of book I would want to write, which is an affectionate book. You know, when Bill Moyers talks about Lyndon Johnson,
right?
He does it with affection,
right?
And Lord knows he had a few warts, and I think this is a good thing. And I think it's only in the Clinton years that we've kind of come to assume that people who go into the inside, you know, eventually will be, you know, kind of run screaming from the room to want to relate the horrors that they saw.
Clinton's president changed everything, I think. It really has. And the effects of it will be seen for years to come. And I think one of the reasons that George Bush won the election, it was an anti-Clinton vote. The same reason that Jimmy Carter won, because it was anti-Nixon and Watergate.
No question.
Absolutely. Yeah. And the country's smart. You know, they know how to put it together.
You know, what's amazing is that an incumbent party lost when there was unparalleled prosperity and peace.
It's unbelievable. All right, we got to hold for a break. We'll come right back with Stuart Stevens, who's given us an interesting insight into George Bush. And we made him a Middle East expert also for the same dollar. We'll be right back.
In modern Middle East history, only one peace treaty has stood the test of time, the 1978 Camp David Accord. In the new documentary film, Backdoor Channels, The Price of Peace, learn the true story behind the greatest diplomatic achievement of our time and its lessons for the future.
The price of peace is very high, to have this courageous man and my close friend killed.
Winner of the Telly Award for Best Cultural Program. Now available at select stores, including Barnes & Noble, and online at Amazon.com. Now get the book the hit movie was based on, Leon Charney's Backdoor Channels. Learn about the backdoor channel negotiations that led to the historic 1978 Israeli-Egyptian peace treaty. Become a witness to history and order Backdoor Channels online at Amazon or Barnes & Noble. Also available at all other retailers and booksellers. Or download the audiobook at iTunes or Audible.com. Relive history. Order Backdoor Channels. Leon Charney sets out to discover the true meaning of the Kaddish, the Jewish custom of reciting a prayer to commemorate the death of a close relative. Join Charney as he finds out the history of the Kaddish and how it has evolved. Reviewed as a refreshing walk through Jewish history and a book that deserves to be read by both Jews and non-Jews, The Mystery of the Kaddish is now available online at Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and all other retailers and booksellers. Or download the audiobook at Audible.com or on iTunes. Discover The Mystery of the Kaddish. Get best-selling author Leon Charney's latest book, The Battle of the Two Talmuds. Join Charney as he explores years of Jewish history to find out why and how Talmudic scholars and rabbis abandoned the Holy Land for the lands of the diaspora. Learn about the power struggles behind the creation of the Jerusalem and Babylonian Talmuds. It's a book critics call engaging and enlightening. A book which will be of interest to people of every faith. Now available at Amazon and Barnes & Noble. Or download the audiobook of The Battle of the Two Talmuds at iTunes or Audible.com.
Available now over iTunes, Amazon, and Google Play. Leon Charney's cantorial CD and disco long. Listen as Charney movingly sings El Mole Rachamim and Charney's amazing rendition of a disco remix of Adon Olam, all sung in the incredible and individual Charney style. Also listen to the CDs on Rhapsody. Download Leon Charney's cantorial songs and disco long, the disco remix of Adon Olam on Amazon, iTunes, and Google Play. Or listen in on Rhapsody, all available now.
We're back. The book is The Big Enchilada. Enchilada. What does enchilada mean for our audience?
Enchilada would be both the presidential race and the president.
All right. We got that clear. It's by Stuart Stevens, and it's all about the George W. Bush campaign. When I say John McCain, what happens?
I'm glad we won. it's kind of touch and go there. Losing New Hampshire.
In North Carolina when that big thing
In South Carolina, yeah.
The university went to?
Bob Jones.
Bob Jones.
Yeah, I was there.
Tell me about that.
It's an interesting question. You know, later, of course, President apologized for not speaking out more at Bob Jones about his points of disagreement. Though, you know, to a certain degree, I always thought it was somewhat of a bum rap because, you know, he was asked immediately afterwards in a press conference, did he agree with the policy on interracial dating? And he all but took the person's head off who asked the question. Pointed out the fact that his brother is married to a Hispanic woman.
But was he worried about McCain during the campaign?
This campaign always thought that it would win. Always. Despite some evidence to the contrary along the way. That confidence created a steadiness inside the campaign that is reflective, I think, of the president's management style and his personality. You know, Ronald Reagan won New Hampshire and fired people. We lost by 19 points, which is one of the more humiliating defeats in political history. And then Governor Bush called everybody in, you know, about a half dozen after the exit polls came in, and it was clear we were going to lose. We thought we'd probably lose. We didn't think we'd lose by 19 points. And said, look, you know, this isn't anybody's fault. I made mistakes. Everybody
really?
Made mistakes.
That's pretty nice.
We're going to win South Carolina. This is over. We move on. And it was one of those sort of turning points in the campaign internally where, you know, had it not been like that, people would have started to really lose their confidence, for one thing. Wonder who was going to get fired. And there were all these press reports that, you know, there'd be
a mass firing.
Yeah.
No, but that's a very interesting point.
He was rock solid.
It's very interesting.
Almost relieved. Okay, this is over. We lost, but let's move on. You know, he has a very...
It reminds me of a story of a lawyer who kept winning cases all the time. And he said to me, I hope I lose one. I says, yeah, but I hope it's not mine.
Well, you know, he's someone who doesn't have a lot of emotional ups and downs in a way that affects his judgment.
He's very steady.
And I think, you know, we've seen that. There's really, I think, been two big moments in this presidency so far. One of their choosing, one not of the choosing, the China plane incident.
Right.
You know, literally fell out of the sky.
Right.
And I think that the country got a sense of the steadiness that he was handling that. And then stem cells, which, like it or not like it, it's difficult to make a case that it wasn't a thoughtful decision, even if you don't agree with it. And it's my feeling that as a couple, the first lady and the president will wear very well on people as you get to know them more.
They get along very well.
Yeah, and she's just a
nice lady.
She's utterly delightful. A huge reader.
Does she have a sense of humor too?
Yeah, they love to
kibitz,
to tweak each other. They're very, very funny. In the campaign when we would spend time with them, she was. They both were always kind of worried about us, like how you holding up.
That's important.
You know,
did you travel on a campaign plane?
Yeah, I hate it, but yeah.
How was
some.
The food?
The food's gotten better since you did it with.
I hated it.
But it's we all gained weight. You never can exercise enough. It's like a polite kidnapping. You know, people with guns tell you where to go. I find it incredibly difficult to get anything done. You know, one of the scenes I describe in the book is sort of the relationship between, you know, what we always call the road, you know, out there, and headquarters. And it's always struck me as a relationship sort of like between astronauts and mission control. And astronauts always think the mission control is like totally out of touch and has no idea of what's going on and what it's really like up here in this capsule, you know. And the mission control always thinks that the people, you know, up there in the capsule are, you know, almost on the edge there, just have to be calm, they might lose it here, you know. And there's always these sort of funny, we used to have these, you know, hysterical...
But it's very important what you said, because a lot of these candidates, they have highs and lows. And that affects the whole campaign. It puts a lot of tension in the people who are working with them.
Right.
And if he's steady as you go, which it seems to be he is, if you read his medical report, everything seems to be balanced there, you know? And that's important. And I think you're right. He looks at everything from a management style, like it's a Harvard Business School, book plan, and that's the way I'm going to do it. So that's interesting. The question is, can one person really run this world today? Basically, that's always...
Well, I think no is the answer.
I do, too. What's his relationship with Cheney?
Well, I think, I'd never spent any time with the vice president until the campaign, and I spent a good bit of time with he and his family preparing for the debates. And as soon as you do, you understand why everybody who's ever met Dick Cheney, like President of the United States since he was like 33 or something, want him in the room when they're making big decisions. Incredible steadiness, a droll sense of humor that is very nice to have in moments of high tension. You know, I remember seeing him on election night when we just lost Pennsylvania. They called Florida against us. It looks like, you know, we called Michigan against us. And he said, well, got them just where we want them now. You know, and this is, he always has this ability to sort
of... Where were you in the election night?
I was mostly at headquarters.
And were you nervous?
Nervous is, we were beyond nervousness.
Really? Frenetic?
You know, it was one of these rare moments in life where you're aware of the fact that you're in the middle of something that will never happen again.
It's historic.
Yeah, that this was just so... It crazy. And it really started that afternoon when we got the first exit polls in. And, you know, we thought we were going to win comfortably. I mean, it was not spin, for better or worse.
Really?
Yeah. We did. We thought we'd, you know, win by several points in the
popular vote. Those polls are pretty accurate, because when I flew with Jimmy Carter,
right,
it was the day before, and if the hostages weren't free at that time, the Iranian hostages,
right,
the polls were telling us he was going to lose.
Right.
And that night, we knew it. I mean, he knew he was going down.
Yeah, it sort of the bottom kind of fell out that weekend.
That's right.
It was very
so
close.
So you
to
people
the
really believed you were going to win.
We did.
Bill Clinton believed he was going to win, too. So those polls are fairly accurate.
We, you know, our numbers showed us winning in a modest landslide. We thought that the same thing would happen as did with Reagan and Carter, that ultimately undecided voters would come our way. The problem was just that the economy was so good. You know, on election day, consumer confidence was at the highest level it's ever been since they started tracking
consumer confidence.
And ultimately it...
And it was a great market at that time. There was a great stock market.
Yeah. If we had the election and the environment that we're in today, we would have won easily. But it, you know, we used to joke in the campaign that the slogan ought to be, times have never been better, vote for change. it was an incredible night. You know,
it was
they
an incredible couple of weeks, though, wasn't it?
It was awful. Just awful.
But he never thought he was going to lose it, did he?
No. He was prepared to lose.
Really?
Yes. And I think that both he and Vice President Gore, it's very difficult to imagine how hard that purgatory was for them of Florida, because they're guys who, I think, could have accepted defeat, were ready to win, obviously. But not knowing either, I think, it placed them both, you know. How do you act? You don't want to seem presumptuous, but you don't want to seem defeated.
Torture.
Yeah, it was just, it was the worst. And for those of us in Austin, you know, it was sort of
like...
What
did you do to that period. There's not much to do, right?
No. I mean, we have, you know, we used to come up with spots that we'd doodle on napkins to attack the Florida Supreme Court, you know. We like, who are these people in these black robes?
By the way, I think you had better lawyers, no matter what. What's his name? Du Bois? What was his name?
Bois, yeah.
I think he made a mistake. I think his attack was incorrect. As a lawyer, I say that. And I think history will show it. Oh, I don't know, you know, if it would have changed anything, but I think his movements were wrong. We got to cut for another break, and we'll talk a little bit about what you think Supreme Court did. Was it too political? Obviously, you're going to say no, but let's air the subject. We'll be right back.
In modern Middle East history, only one peace treaty has stood the test of time, the 1978 Camp David Accord. In the new documentary film, Backdoor Channels, The Price of Peace, learn the true story behind the greatest diplomatic achievement of our time and its lessons for the future.
The price of peace is very high, to have this courageous man and my close friend killed.
Winner of the Telly Award for Best Cultural Program. Now available at select stores, including Barnes & Noble, and online at Amazon.com. Now get the book the hit movie was based on, Leon Charney's Backdoor Channels. Learn about the backdoor channel negotiations that led to the historic 1978 Israeli-Egyptian peace treaty. Become a witness to history and order Backdoor Channels online at Amazon or Barnes & Noble. Also available at all other retailers and booksellers. Or download the audiobook at iTunes or Audible.com. Relive history. Order Backdoor Channels. Leon Charney sets out to discover the true meaning of the Kaddish, the Jewish custom of reciting a prayer to commemorate the death of a close relative. Join Charney as he finds out the history of the Kaddish and how it has evolved. Reviewed as a refreshing walk through Jewish history and a book that deserves to be read by both Jews and non-Jews, The Mystery of the Kaddish is now available online at Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and all other retailers and booksellers. Or download the audiobook at audible.com or on iTunes. Discover The Mystery of the Kaddish. Get best-selling author Leon Charney's latest book, The Battle of the Two Talmuds. Join Charney as he explores years of Jewish history to find out why and how Talmudic scholars and rabbis abandoned the Holy Land for the lands of the diaspora. Learn about the power struggles behind the creation of the Jerusalem and Babylonian Talmuds. It's a book critics call engaging and enlightening. A book which will be of interest to people of every faith. Now available at Amazon and Barnes & Noble. Or download the audiobook of The Battle of the Two Talmuds at iTunes or Audible.com.
We're back with Stuart Stevens, the big enchilada. Enchilada, you know, it's, I guess, a Spanish word. I'm not sure what it means, right? Enchilada. Anyway, it's a great book, and it's about George W. Bush. And as you know, and if you don't know, I guess you ought to turn off because this is an intelligent program, but the Supreme Court ruled basically that George Bush would be the president of the United States. There are many, like a fellow named Dershowitz, who thinks that's the worst thing that happened since the Jewish rabbi ate pigs, you know, if it ever happened, but it never does. Tell me, I'm sure you're in favor of what happened. Are you worried about the country, though, and the Supreme Court politicizing things?
Well, you know, my take on this is greatly influenced by growing up in Mississippi, because I'm old enough to remember vividly Impeacher or Warren billboards in Mississippi.
Right.
And a lot of white Southerners didn't like the Supreme Court because they were taking positions that they didn't agree with. But fortunately, we didn't impeach Earl Warren, and the Supreme Court was the law of the land. This is, to me, completely similar. A lot of people, and I can understand this in the sense that if my candidate won the popular vote but lost in the Electoral College, I'd be sorely disappointed, if not bitter. But it's... that's the way we do things in this country.
Some place a decision had to be made.
Yeah, I mean, I talk about this in the book, which really isn't much about Florida. But, you know, the problem Gore had in Florida was that he just kept losing. Had he won some of these votes, he would have won. I mean, it's really not much more complicated than that.
There were some books that I read that your team was really well prepared, that you got to the servicemen's votes, and you knew exactly where you were going.
That's kind of a myth, actually.
Really?
I wish that we had been. You know, there was actually a very...
Really?
Yeah, from the very beginning, the Gore campaign had prepared for this much better than we had. You know, they had anticipated the idea that it might...
Really?
...go into recounts, yeah. And in fact, there's a funny story where Ben Ginsburg, who was the Bush campaign lawyer.
Right.
We were sitting around headquarters, you know, at 4 o'clock in the morning and election night, and he said, well, you know, I got to go to Tallahassee. He was with Don Evans, who's the campaign chairman, now commerce secretary. So they rounded up, you know, it was Ben and a couple of guys, and they flew, and they were getting off the plane in Tallahassee when the Gore campaign landed, and 85 people walked off the Gore campaign plane.
Really?
And, you know, Ben says it was like the battleship Galactica had landed, you know, and he was like him and two other guys, and he was thinking, you know, this could be a problem. And then, you know, they got off the start much quicker. You know, they appointed Christopher right away.
You guys brought Jim Baker in.
But, you know, it was a day or two later. We were of the opinion this would be over in a few days, initially. I mean, that's probably a confession, but it's true. And that is the history of most recounts.
But which way? You thought you'd win?
Yeah, we thought we'd win, yeah. I mean, the history of recounts is whoever's ahead wins, unless it's just a tiny margin. And that almost always happens. So we thought there'd be the first recount, you know, which they had the and that would extend our lead, we expected. We didn't expect it to drop. And then we'd win. And Gore would drop it, and we'd go on. But, you know, in that first recount, we dropped votes, which was a bit disconcerting. And then it was clear that Gore was going to go on and fight. And then it was clear that nobody had any idea what the process should be.
That's right.
I mean,
it was like being
in the middle of a Super Bowl, and you don't know if field goals in the third quarter are going to count 5 points or 3 points, or if they're going to allow field goals, and they're going to have a meeting during the half to decide this, but then, you know, it depends on what they eat. I mean, it was crazy.
That's exactly right. We never had a process. And at the end of the day, I guess the Supreme Court had to do it. No one else was doing it. And they had to terminate it. This was agonizing.
Well, I think, you know, I've sort of been bemused, you know, one of the ways we got into this mess was the fact that the networks depended upon one source of information,
right.
The Voter News
That's
Service.
Right.
And then they've since, to see if they were right the first time, depending on that one source of information, a lot of these news organizations have combined again to go in and count the votes again, and they're sort of recreating the scenario to me that got them in the mess in the first place. But there's not been any reason to believe any of the recounts or, you know, postmortems that they've done that it would have been any different. It's just a question of what the margin would have been.
You speak, Stu, to these guys up at the White House. Were they pretty upset when the Congress changed, the Senate changed, when Dash replaced your boy in Mississippi?
Mr. Trent Lott. Perplexed, I think, is a better kind of a
really?
Bit.
You're a good author.
A bit, you know, a bit sort of like, huh?
I would bet they were taking Maalox.
I mean, there may have been some of that, but I mean, it was more, they're pretty good at rolling with the punches, you know. One can make a case politically, it's better for Bush now.
How?
He can
lay more things on the Democratic Congress?
Yeah, and any achievements are more clearly that of a compromise or of working with the other side, which is sort of a Bush hallmark.
I would think that Bush would do well only because he has a great personality and he looks to really align himself. And that works. As you know, Lyndon Johnson was able to do that because he knew how to get along with those people. And maybe George Sr. wasn't that good at it, but George W. Seems to be much better at that.
You know, the other quality I think that the president has that people on the Hill are getting a sense of, and that is that he doesn't always have to be in the spotlight.
That's true.
And
he doesn't hug the mic. You're absolutely right.
And, you know, he's actually, to my amusement, been criticized for that because, you know, like when the serviceman came home finally from China, that he wasn't there to hug everyone, you know?
Right.
I mean, I think that he has a very good sense of who he is and how he wants to conduct his presidency.
It's a management style, and sometimes...
And it's a personal style.
And you let your people go out there and do it for you. And you're right. I mean, he appears on television, I think, far less than Bill Clinton. I mean,
right.
Clinton was all over. He liked the mic, and he was all over the place. And
I think that helps with Congress, because I think that it allows Congress to... you know, he knows that each of them, in their own right, think that they're a big deal, and some of them actually are a big deal. And I think that he has a healthy respect that if he, without them, nothing's going to get done. I mean, the tax cut, you know, to me is absolutely fascinating. You know, it never really caught on in the campaign. Never helped us that much. Our base liked it, but it never became a dominant issue in the campaign. And it's amazing to me that once he became president, he was able to sell the tax cut.
All right, we got a few seconds. His relationship with John McCain today?
I think mutual respect. I think they like each other more than the press allows.
Really?
Yeah, I do. I think the staff is more...
As a good Republican, you think McCain will go out on his own?
And No. Never? No. I think John McCain will spend the rest of his life in the Republican Party. I don't think, unlike Jeffords, he won't have a late midlife crisis.
Unlike which one?
Jeffords.
Oh.
You know, it used to be he just went out and bought a sports car, but, you know, Jeffords had to switch parties. But I think McCain enjoys being a maverick, and I think that the White House has the good sense to allow him to be a maverick. But when push comes to shove, I think he'll spend the rest of his life in the party. And he's good for the party. McCain expands the party.
That's true. How are the blacks doing in the Republican Party?
Well,
I know Watts very well. I've interviewed him, by the way.
Right, and it should, you know, it is absolutely historic, of course, that the national security apparatus is for the first time all African American.
That's true.
Republicans Party has never succeeded in breaking through the color barrier the way we should. And it's one of our great failures, and it continues to be a failure. And it is absolutely perplexing to us. We can't pretend that we've succeeded on it. And
are you doing better with middle-level black people? You know, are they becoming Republicans?
Yeah, I mean, you see high water marks like Christy Whitman, you know, can get upwards of 20%.
Right.
But we just seem to be in a box that is somewhere between 9 and 15% for the most part, and we've got to do better.
All right, we're running out of time, Stuart.
Thank you, buddy.
Is George Pataki your next governor?
I think so, sure.
Really? Is he close with George W.?
They like each other a lot. You know, though Pataki does disagree with him often.
You've heard the last word. The book is The Big Enchilada, and it's by Stuart Stevens, all about George W. We'll see you next week, and we hope the Middle East cools off a little bit. Shimon Peres and Arafat are going to meet. They've met a lot before, so cross your fingers if you're not Jewish.